morning everyone. Today's topic is ocular complications of systemic medications. Every day in our OPD we see patients with various eye problems and many of them are already on long list of systemic medications. As you find out today, there are many medications which will cause their effect on ocular health. As an eye care provider, it is important for me to know the side effects, but it's equally important for you as prescribers to know them as well. I have divided this topic based on the drugs affecting ocular structures from anterior to posterior. I'll try to explain the clinical cases wherever possible. So let us start with the anterior most part, that is cornea. Here is a 50-year-old woman complaining of color halos in both the eyes since few weeks. On examination, her best guided visual acuity is normal in both the eyes. On examination of the anterior segment, there were corneal deposits noted in the inferior cornea. Similar picture was also seen in the other eye. She is a known case of atrial fibrillation since 2 years. So this is nothing but amiodarone-induced otex keratopathy. It causes otex keratopathy in nearly all the patients who are on amiodarone. But luckily, it will not cause any vision complaints except for color halos in very few patients. Signs include bilateral inferior otex keratopathy. Very few patients may develop anterior subcapsular lenticular opacity, and very rarely it can cause optic neuropathy. Treatment is usually not required, and it is not advisable to discontinue amiodarone as the otex keratopathy caused by this drug is usually asymptomatic. Like amiodarone, there are so many drugs which can cause otex keratopathy. Important one amongst them are chloroquine, hydroxychloroquine, atovaquone, tamoxifen and endomethacin. It is hypothesized that these drugs are amphiphilic drugs. They form complexes with phospholipids present in the cornea. Once they form these complexes, they can't get metabolized by the lysosomal phospholipases. So they'll get accumulated in the subepithelial cornea. As they are subepithelial, they will not cause any ocular irritation to the patient. Like otex keratopathy, there are so many diseases and drugs which can cause corneal stromal deposits. Clofrenazine is used as sedative and antipsychotic medications. When used for long term, they can cause golden brown depositions in the deep cornea, desmoid membrane and endothelium. This is a cross section of the cornea. This is the epithelial side and this is the endothelial side where you can see the drug deposition. Argyrosis will occur secondary to silver deposition and chrysiasis will occur secondary to gold deposition. In medicine, gold is used as anti-rheumatic agent. When it is used for long term, it can cause deposition of purple glistening particles in the cornea. Luckily, all these deposits will not cause any vision complaints. Hence, once we stop the drug, all these deposits will go away. Coming to the lens, when the drugs affect the lens, they will cause drug-induced cataract. Here is a 30-year-old gentleman complaining of blurring of vision in both the eyes since 6 months. He is a known case of bronchial asthma on steroid inhalers. This is a retroillumination picture of the lens. You can see here, in the center, there is a posterior subcapsular opacity. This is caused by steroid. The relationship between the dose, duration and the development of the cataract is not clear. But it is thought that patients receiving less than 10 mg prednisolone or equivalent, or if they are treated for less than 4 years, they are immune to the cataract formation. It is important to note that children develop cataract faster than the adults when they are on steroids. Steroids like dexamethasone and betamethasone cause cataract changes very early. Signs include central lenticular opacity, which will start at the posterior pole and later they become posterior subcapsular opacities. Patients may have associated raised intraocular pressure. Treatment includes withdrawal of the steroids. If they are very early opacities, they can regress, but if they are advanced, patients will definitely require cataract surgery. There is a whole list of drugs which can cause drug-induced cataract. Important amongst them are allopurinol, busulfan, lovastatin, clofrenazine, sorolans, etc. Coming to the uvea, which is the middle and vascular layer of the eye. When the drugs affect the uvea, they will cause drug-induced uveitis. Here is an interesting case A 26-year-old gentleman complaining of blurring of vision, pain and photophobia. Photophobia, that is intolerance to the light in the left eye. He is a known case of acquired immune deficiency syndrome on heart therapy. He is also on sulfamethoxazole, trimethoprim, clindamycin, fluconazole for opportunistic infections. He is on clarithromycin, ethambutol and rifabutin. On examination, we could see collection of pus in the anterior chamber, that is between the cornea and the iris, we could see the collection of pus. This is a picture of acute anterior uveitis. Amongst the so many drugs mentioned, it is a rifabutin which is a culprit here. Rifabutin, if it is used for more than 600 mg per day for a duration of 7 months, it can cause uveitis. Patient, if additionally on clarithromycin and ritonavir, the toxicity increases because these drugs will inhibit the cytochrome P450 pathway, which will help in the metabolism of the rifabutin. Symptoms include, like any other acute anterior uveitis, there will be redness, pain and photophobia. Signs include acute anterior uveitis. If the patient has along with vitritis, it can give us a picture of endophthalmitis. Treatment includes withdrawal of the drugs or reduction of the dose. There are some other drugs like sitagliptin used in CMV retinitis, fluoroquinolones, bisphosphonates. They also can cause drug-induced uveitis. Coming to the retina, here is a 57-year-old lady complaining of bilateral central photoxias, means flashing of light since 2 years. She is a known case of Sjögren syndrome and inflammatory arthritis. Currently, she is on prednisone and methotrexate. On further asking, she told she was on hydroxychloroquine 200 mg BD for almost 10 years. She has stopped the medication since 1 year. On ocular examination, her best ever visual acuity is mildly reduced in both the eyes, but rest of the anterior segment examination, including pupils, extraocular movements, visual fields and IOP were normal. This is a fundus picture of the patient. Optic disc appear healthy with cup disc ratio of 0.3. Vessels emerging from the optic disc are normal. But here we can see there's a paracentral depigmentation in the macular area, sparing the fovea. When we did the visual field examination, corresponding to her fundus, there were deep paracentral scotomas noted in both the eyes. This is a ST-OCT picture of the same patient. ST-OCT means spectral domain optical coherence tomography. It's a non-invasive imaging technique which has revolutionized ophthalmology. It's almost like looking like a histological section of the retina. Fluoroquine affects the RPE layer of the retina. So there will be destruction of RPE and photoreceptor layer. So here we can see these are the inner retinal layers and this is the outer retinal layer which has become thin because of the fluoroquine toxicity. Autofluorescence is also a non-invasive imaging technique. It will map the presence of lipofuscin in the retinal pigment epithelium. Lipofuscin will get accumulated in the eye whenever the RPE cells are not functioning well. So here we can see, because of the lipofuscin deposition, there are hyper-intense signals around the macula in both the eyes. So with all these examinations and tests, we come to a conclusion that it is nothing but HCQ toxicity. Coming to the discussion, chloroquine and hydroxychloroquine are used to treat malaria, but of late they are being used as disease-modifying anti-rheumatic agents in the treatment of rheumatoid arthritis and systemic lupus erythematosus. Chloroquine is supposed to be more toxic than hydroxychloroquine. Incidence of this toxicity depends on the dose and duration. If the patient is using for 5 years, there is a chance of 1%. If it is 10 years, 2%. The risk increases if it is more than 20 years to 20%. So it is very important to reassure the patient that both these drugs are safe and effective if the side effects are monitored properly. There are certain risk factors to consider. According to 2016 guidelines, if the daily dosage of hydroxychloroquine increases more than 5 mg per kg, chloroquine if it increases more than 2.3 mg per kg body weight, and if the duration is more than 5 years, there is a risk of retinopathy. If the patient is additionally having renal insufficiency, as the metabolism of the drug is getting affected, the toxicity increases. Concomitant use of drugs like tamoxifen, macular diseases increase the risk. There is no clear association between age, liver disease, and genetic factors. Patients will present with decreased vision, flashing of lights, paracentral scotoma, image distortion, night vision problems and color vision problems. Early functional changes can be picked up by visual field test, OCT, multifocal ERG, autofluorescence. But I would like to highlight the importance of ancillary chart. This is an ancillary chart which we can give to the patient, and patient can do this test at their home. It's a very cost effective test. We'll ask the patient to look at the central dot, and if they are seeing any distortion of the lines, it means that there is some macular function problem. Late tests pick up the structural changes. They are in the form of decreased visual acuity, bullseye maculopathy on fundus examination, fundus fluorescence changes, visual field 24-2, and full field ERG can pick up only late changes. So what are the recommended screening guidelines for hydroxychloroquine toxicity? Baseline screening should be done within 1 year of starting the therapy. They are in the form of slit lamp examination, visual field test and OCT. Only if it is negative and there are no risk factors, we can repeat the annual screening after 5 years. If there are any risk factors, we need to do early annual screening. Coming to the treatment, as soon as we detect there is hydroxychloroquine toxicity, we need to discontinue the therapy. There are still numerous reports of continued vision loss even after stopping the therapy. And some degree of visual recovery is only possible if it is stopped early. So, early detection is vital here. Coming to the optic nerve. When the drugs affect the optic nerve, they belong to the category of toxic optic neuropathies. Generalized symptoms include bilateral subacute painless central vision loss and color desaturation. Signs include reduced bilateral visual acuity. On the field examination, there will be bilateral central or centrosecal psychocentral scotomas. There are so many drugs which can cause toxic optic neuropathies. Important ones amongst them are amiodarone, cyclosporine, chlorambucil, chloramphenicol, cisplatin, etc., etc. But most important one amongst them is ethambutol, which we use for as a first-line antitubercular therapy. The toxicity of the ethambutol is again dose and duration dependent. If it is used for more than 25 mg per kg, there can be toxicity within 3 to 6 months. The same dosage is less than 50 mg. If you are using for more than 15 mg per kg, we need to screen the patient every 4 weeks. Prognosis of this toxicity is very good. Once we stop the therapy, visual recovery usually happens within a year. So with this, I would like to complete my topic. I hope I have highlighted the importance of ocular screening to detect early drug toxicities. Thank you.